But the goal, according to this group, is that we need to double the global food, feed, fiber, and fuel production on existing farmland within the 21st century with production systems that enable food security, use resources more efficiently, enhance diversity and ecosystem health, and are economically viable and socially responsible. So with that in mind, it is clear that we will be needing to improve our technologies over the course of time, as plant breeders have always done. I think we're some of the most resourceful people on the planet. As we are improving plants, the goals can be various things besides just higher yield. It could be resistance to disease and insects, tolerance to various environmental conditions. Maybe it's changing the size or shape or the time to maturity of the plant, various other environmental adaptations, quality, nutrition, or even aesthetics, depending on what crop you're working with. But the goals can be varied. And as you all know, hopefully, how plant breeding works, you have a generation, you select some plants, you cross those, and you create a new generation, a new population, where you have hopefully altered the frequency of the trait. In this case, we're picking the highest, the tallest plants, and we get a population of taller plants by on average. This should seem pretty obvious to you, but there's a lot of thinking that goes into this. For example, how do we choose this population to start from? How do we choose the best individuals here? How do we choose the best individuals here? If these two are highly related, maybe that would not be as good of a choice for creating the next generation as if we had chosen maybe this one and this one, for example. So there's a lot of creative thinking and advanced science that can go into some of these decisions. So how do we know which plants to select? How do we get the best ones? Traditionally, the best way to do this is to do variety trials to measure yield. And that involves growing many replications of the given variety that you're trying to test in all the different locations throughout the region of interest over the course of many years and directly measure all the traits of interest and make lots of crosses. Now the problem is that's very expensive. So if you were to do all of those things, you're gonna run out of money pretty quickly. And so what we have to do is make compromises or new methods that approximate those methods. So ways we can cut corners. Perhaps instead of growing a lot of replications, maybe a reasonable approximation of a variety's performance could be to replicate genes as opposed to whole varieties. So if you were growing related individuals, you could use, instead of that variety, you could borrow information from relatives. So calculate blobs, for example. This requires genotyping. So you're always gonna be making a trade-off between what you can afford to do. So it depends on what is cheap and what is expensive. Instead of many locations throughout your region of interest over the course of years, maybe it's possible to use something like crop growth models that can make predictions across different environments and climates. In order to do that, you need to have pretty good parameterization and information about in the environment. And instead of directly measuring the traits, maybe we could statistically model the traits using some training data and some fancy math. Obviously, I'm not going to be talking in depth a lot about the fancy math today, which is why I called it fancy math, but there are some exciting things that can be done. And instead of using the traits of interest, we could use correlated or related traits that are easier or cheaper to measure. Perhaps they're more accurate or more reliable, predictable, and maybe more heritable. And that involves using other types of phenotypes, including high throughput phenotyping. Now, the one thing that's harder to get around is making lots of crosses, but we can also optimize our cross predictions using genotyping and some more fancy math. And maybe now and into the future, using targeted genetic changes, depending on the system that you're in, requiring some gene editing technology. So there's lots of ways that plant breeders have, I'll say, evolved over the years to be able to cut some corners in our work. And the first one we're going to talk about is this one here, using crop growth models to make predictions. Now, this is the only equation in the presentation, I promise. So if this gives you anxiety, it'll be over soon. But you should be familiar with how we describe phenotype as a combination of the variation of genetics, environment, and their interaction. Or VP equals VG plus VE plus G by E. And this is important because each of these things is a contributor. And so oftentimes some people will tend to focus on one and forget about the others. Some people also include VM for management, and then also the interactions of those things. It really depends on if you're looking at it from the perspective of a farmer or the perspective of the plant. Because as far as the plant is concerned, anything that you're doing as far as management is part of its environment. So you can include management under the environment variation writ large. However, if you're a farmer, environment is usually something that you can't really control, whereas the management is what you have a hand in changing. So depending on who you're talking to, that can be an important distinction. Environmental variation encompasses a lot of things. It's weather, and I talk from the perspective of doing mostly field-based research, but keep in mind that all of these things can apply to greenhouses, growth chambers, other locations as well. And if you have never seen firsthand edge effects in a greenhouse or growth chamber, believe me, they can be very significant, or greenhouse to greenhouse effects, that sort of thing. So temperature, radiation, rain, moisture, wind, humidity, air pressure, all of these things can affect the way that the plant grows in the environment. Soil is hugely important, especially the water holding capacity, the water table level, and any nutrients, pH, microbial community, et cetera, all kinds of things can affect the plant and how it grows. You can also have things like edge and alley effects and disease, weed, insect pressure. All of these things can contribute. So if you're looking at some phenotypes and asking how genotype impacts those phenotypes, you're missing a giant portion of that equation that we just looked at, because environmental variation contributes a huge amount. Now, ways that you can classify environmental variation in a field study. You can look at field variability, and maybe you go to the soil map for the USDA and say, well, this site looks pretty uniform. It's all one soil type. You know, maybe that's a pretty good location to have my study. But if you look at other types of images, say you look at the satellite imagery and you think, well, maybe that looks okay. But if you look at the elevation or the pH, for example, there can be huge gradients across the field. And so it's not always easy to tell what is and is not uniform, which is why it is important to have really good statistical and experimental design methods to help with this issue. Here's some other examples in real life of field variability that can be caused if you look at it from above. So these faint lines are caused by tile lines that are under the ground there. Here we have center pivot tracks that might be left, and this can be something that affects that season, obviously, if your plants get flattened, but it can also have an effect in perpetuity into the future. So the next year's crop, even if it's not under a center pivot, if it was previously there, it can have an impact. You can have soil variation that causes extreme differences. Obviously, edge effects are an issue. I put this one in as a joke, but for breeders who have a nursery and, you know, their observations or whatever, there are human-induced variations that can occur. So it's a joke that it's not really a crop circle, but somebody has come in there and done something to those plants, and that can occur in your field trials. So you never have, you can never be too sure about excluding the human element. So according to Rex Bernardo, there's three ways that you can handle environmental variation. You can ignore it, you can correct it, or you can exploit it. So as breeders, these are sort of the three standard things that we can do. Ignoring it means maybe that the effects are not adequately large enough to change your conclusions or outcomes. So you don't need to go through a very complicated statistical process if the conclusion is obvious, right? Maybe the environmental variation, it's there, but maybe it's not that important. You could correct it. Beforehand, you could choose uniform field sites for your trials. Afterwards, you can use statistical models to account for any known effects. But either way you do it, you need to choose an experimental design that includes checks and allows you to estimate the variance within your statistical model. The third thing is you can exploit it. As a breeder, maybe you want to characterize your locations so that you can choose them strategically to encompass a range of environments within your breeding, your target breeding regions. So if you know you have some couple of environments that are always really weird, maybe you want to embrace that and actually test things in those locations so that whatever variety you produce would be able to grow in a wide range of environments. So we can observe and we can measure environmental variation. But how do we know how plants will react to that variation? In this case, we have maybe a particularly dry year, and this variety, which is drought tolerant, is growing pretty well, and this one that is drought susceptible is clearly not. And that is kind of the definition of a genetic difference, but it can also be G by E, because under G by E, you would not, under well-watered conditions, you would not necessarily see a difference, but under certain conditions you do. So state of the art of prediction from a breeding and genetics perspective, we can predict traits using just genetic information. So that's genomic prediction. If you have genotypes and phenotypes, you can build a model that predicts the phenotype from just the genotype. The pitfall of that is that it has limited application across diverse environments. As soon as you start trying to predict into something that was not observed, the model will fall apart. You can incorporate weather data as coefficients in those models, but then you're not really accounting for varietal differences. I have seen approaches where people have used at least a basic level of phenology, so when the plant flowers, to estimate when that particular weather event might have impacted the plant. But the problem is that you're still looking at a lot of data points that are difficult to condense. So if you're collecting weather data, let's say you're collecting temperature every 10 minutes and you're collecting rainfall and solar radiation, you could have very easily a million data points by the end of your season. And the amount of sun on August 10th may or may not be predictive for that particular growing season. And the real issue is if you have a drought event, let's say in late June, that could be impacting varieties differently. Maybe one is at flowering at that stage. Maybe one is still in its vegetative phase. Maybe one is, so using those weather coefficients is difficult in two senses. One, because there's so many and it's difficult to find which ones might be relevant, but also because they'll be impacting different genotypes differently. So another approach is you could use physiological modeling or crop growth models to predict the growth in a given or predicted environment. However, this is variety limited. Traditionally, crop growth models are parameterized for a species. So there would be like the maize model in a certain package of software. Maybe they would have three or four different genotypes you could pick from. But it's basically how would corn grow in these different environments. So something that we're working on in our lab is to combine these strengths to overcome the weaknesses. And the way that we're doing this is we're trying to estimate parameters for genotype-specific crop growth modeling. What do I mean by that? I mean, if I was going to create a crop growth model to describe the way that corn is growing, I would need to know a certain number of things about that species or that corn, in our case, that genotype, to be able to parameterize the model. And what we can do is come up with those parameters for every single genotype that we're looking at, and then use that to actually feed into the crop growth model. So the advantage there is that we can ask what is happening to different genotypes on a physiological level throughout the course of the season, which lets us answer this question of what is the impact of the stress on each variety and why. So how does plant growth, development, and response vary by genotype? And this will allow us to transfer those predictive models to other regions and climates and combine information from various approaches. And as the crop modelers like to say, it gets you to the right answer for the right reason. So maybe you knew that this was going to have higher yield, but you didn't really understand why. Is it because it put on more leaves and captured more light? Is it because it had a wider angle for its leaves? Is it because, there could be, maybe it just had really good early season vigor. There could be a lot of different reasons for that yield. So this gives you some insight into that. And it also allows us to take advantage of prior knowledge. There's a lot that's known about plant growth and development, and we can incorporate that into the model that then can predict how a drought, for example, will impact a variety, given that it is in this particular stage of growth. So our goals in this project, and I've tried to put pictures and names of people along the way for those who are involved in the project that I'm talking about at the time, but our goals for this project are to collect targeted phenotypes to parameterize crop growth models. And we're doing that initially by hand, but we're replacing the hand measurements with high throughput data collection, images, spectral data, LIDAR, that sort of thing. And we're trying to improve predictions of unobserved genotypes in unobserved environments by using genetics to predict the parameters of the crop growth models. That was a little bit convoluted, so I'm gonna break that down just a little bit in case you missed it. I talked about how we can use these particular parameters, let's say number of leaves, that's one of the parameters. We can use these parameters to parameterize the crop growth model that then allows us to predict into other environments. So how do we get the unobserved genotypes in there? Well, something like leaf number is highly heritable, more than in something like yield would be, because yield can be impacted a lot by environmental factors. Something like leaf number is not as sensitive to the environment. So you have a highly heritable trait that then you could predict using genetics. So once you can predict the parameters and then use that in the crop growth model, we're hoping that that will improve predictions for the whole, I'm using a lot of hand gestures. I don't know if it comes across in the camera. We're hoping that that improves the prediction for the whole range of work there. So we are using our data to predict other years and locations, including stressful environments or future climate change scenarios. And the way that we're able to do this is we're involved in a project called Genomes to Fields. Genomes to Fields, if you have not heard of it, is a project in maize across many locations in the US and a couple abroad. We grow sets of overlapping genetic material, all of which have been sequenced. We collect the same trait data and we standardize our recording of environmental and management and soil conditions. And then we pool the data for shared access and analysis. This creates not only a great data set, but also a really nice opportunity for graduate student training. I can have a student that comes in and day one has access to multiple years and locations of data, and they can measure something here and then see how that applies elsewhere. So just to give you a sense, the core traits for Genomes to Fields, we measure plant and ear height. Again, this is in maize. Aspects of ear morphology, agronomic data such as stand count, root lodging, stock lodging, flowering time, and then some productivity yield-based measurements. All the collaborators are listed here. You'll notice that here is Texas A&M. You're represented here with Dr. Seth Murray. I like to think of that as one of kind of the stressful locations for a lot of this corn, because some of it is not necessarily tailored to your particular climate and maturity. So it can get a little bit stressed down there sometimes. All right, so what we can do then, we can do detailed phenotyping in our one environment. We collect all the core traits, but then we also collect some other types of traits that we can use to try to optimize and parameterize our models. So the last couple of years, we've been collecting leaf initiation rate throughout the season. Leaf number, I call it the hard way because people have joked about this before. You can go out and just count leaves, but the hard way involves using a Sharpie and actually marking on the leaf as they initiate what leaf number it is. So all the way from leaf one, which is tiny, up to the total number. And that lets you know which actual number on the plant it is. Otherwise, it's kind of hard to, it's easy to lose track of what leaf was what if you didn't have the mark, because the ones at the bottom tend to fall off as they senesce throughout the season. And then we collect largest leaf size and shape as well as the dry weight to get to a specific leaf weight and leaf angles. We also collected a lot of this material on the Wisconsin Diversity Panel. Now this is a panel of maize that was selected to represent the diversity of the species, but it is restricted in its phenology so that it flowers in northern climates, because being in Michigan, we can't really grow a lot of the same varieties that you guys grow in Texas because they would not flower here. The season is just too short. But this allows us to estimate the total leaf area and also capture light capture potential in a given environment. And that's one of the ways that we parameterize variety-specific growth models by looking at, basically we're describing canopy architecture. Now this was based on some work in my postdoc out of Purdue where we were modeling leaf area in sorghum. And this is just an example of how we were doing this processing at the time. We would strip all the leaves off of the plant, take a picture of it, and then segment out the leaves. And for each one, we'd measure the area. And what happens then is you can actually model a nice power function from the leaf areas. So the red line or orange line is the power function as parameterized by the total leaf number, the number of the largest leaf, and the area of the largest leaf. And then the blue dots were the actual observed data. So you'll see that you could not have fabricated a better fit for this type of data, which is great. So what we did is we thought, well, we don't need to measure all that then. We can just measure a subset of the leaves. And so one of the ways we did this, we had the first year I was here, we had an intrepid high school student, believe it or not, who helped build this device with a hand scanner that then scans the leaves and gives us the leaf area measurements. And she measured leaf 6 across all the populations. And then we later measured the ear leaf across the populations as an approximation of the largest leaf. And we did this across basically all of our material. Streamlined code to extract the measurements. She did quality control of the data. She even did genetic mapping. So she did some GWAS projects. This was all in like an 8-week internship. So I thought that was pretty fabulous. I think she's probably off going to med school or something right now. I don't know. Well, undergrad first, I suppose. So for maize, we decided that by measuring leaf 6 in the ear leaf and counting the leaf numbers, we could then use that data point to parameterize this power function and then use leaf 6 to kind of check and see to make sure that we're somewhere in the ballpark. So this power function lets us calculate the total leaf area with this area basically under the curve. We can do linear modeling of leaf number over time, over thermal time, which gives us a leaf initiation rate, which is another parameter that we use in the model. And beautifully, these new traits are heritable and moderately correlated with agronomic traits, although not exactly correlated, or else why would we be wasting our time doing this? That would be exhausting. So the higher heritability is exciting, and we can in fact map traits, map loci that are significant for these traits. And we are working on doing some of the validation, but the fun thing is that this particular population, the Wisconsin Diversity Panel, has had a transcriptome project that's been done already. So we have access to that data, and we can go in and look at candidate genes in the area, see where they're expressed and to what extent, and then pick some mutants for functional analysis. And that work is ongoing. And since this is primarily a breeding circle and not a genetic circle, I'm gonna leave it at that and move on. But just why crop growth models as kind of a summary of this. So we can predict agronomic performance across additional environments, especially stress environments, which is exciting. We can combine crop modeling and remotely sensed features with genomic prediction to innovate ways to inform variety selection. We can identify and genetically map unparameterized variants in the model estimations. This is something I didn't talk about, but you can imagine if you have some number of parameters you've put into your crop growth model, you make a prediction, you're going to get some values for yield. There's going to be a difference between those values for yield and what you actually observe. Now, what could be causing that could just be error, but it also could be something that you're actually missing. Like let's say you were missing information about radiation use efficiency. So a lot of the error could be made up of something that is actually a heritable thing that you could target. So by doing this, looking at the unparameterized variants, you can actually identify explanatory attributes and go back to the biology of what's causing that and then incorporate that in your model in the future. We can also extract new features estimated in the model that might be highly predictive of agronomic traits and highly predictable by remote sensing features. For example, hyperspectral data. That's a good example of, let's say we're missing radiation use efficiency. Maybe we could measure that using spectral data, which would be fantastic. But all this is about increasing accuracy, scale, precision, and innovation for plant breeding. So what are some ways that we're trying to do this now in a more high throughput method rather than by hand? One way is that we created this little device. This is another undergrad that worked with us who created this little device called the Undertaker. It's got two GoPro cameras that trigger simultaneously and you get images like this under the canopy. So we're working with a professor in 3D computer vision in the College of Engineering and then one of my graduate students. And if you cross your eyes, this works kind of like a magic eye, right? So you see kind of like a 3D picture coming from these two images. And that allows us to calculate some distances and depth of field and hopefully get a picture of what the canopy structure and architecture is like without having to count and measure leaves. Other high throughput approaches that we're working with, we are doing hyperspectral leaf scans. And that is a combination of looking at water and nitrogen as well as radiation use efficiency. We have drone-based aerial images that we use. And I would love to give you some updated results on this if you invite me back in a couple years. We just got a new drone that has hyperspectral, VNIR plus VIR, and LiDAR all co-aligned. We've been collecting data frequently this season, this summer, but it's not been processed yet. So I couldn't give you any results from that particular spot, but we're excited about that. I'll talk a little bit about it later. And then we're also doing ground-based imaging of canopy structure and leaf architecture from below ground to try and replace those measurements by hand. And the nice thing is you can anchor all of these repeated measures to thermal time and interpolate across the growing season. So for example, maybe you've got repeated measures of plant heights. I know Seth has put out a paper on this recently, but you can watch the plant grow throughout the season, and maybe the beginning and end of the season look pretty similar, but there's something that happens in the middle where one variety grows a little faster than the other, and that gives it an advantage. So that, I think, is as much of a jump in information as the crop growth modeling approach is, because it allows you to see more biological meaning in some of the numbers, and you have these hidden factors that can come out by doing that. So just as a reminder, this is where we're all kind of coming from. Doing all of this by hand is slow and tedious and error prone, and sometimes just kind of questionable. For example, we had a lodging event. This is a picture from Purdue from a few years back. There was a lodging event and we were trying to estimate, well, what is the plant height or percent lodging? And he's got this height stick here that he's looking at. And you know, what do you even measure? Do you measure the two plants that are standing? Do you try and measure the flatness of what's fallen down? It's really kind of baffling. And the other problem was we couldn't even hardly walk into the field. You'd get twisted ankles and you were stuck in the mud or whatever. But from the drone, you can actually get beautiful images of the relative heights and percent lodging pretty accurately. So that's, I like to tout that as one of the huge advantages of high throughput approaches. So big picture, what does this look like overall? My image of the future here. We'll be collecting phenotypes in an informed and targeted way. So not just spending all of the money on all of the phenotypes all at once for all the plants, but whatever it is you need to know about that particular set of plants, collect those phenotypes. Train your genomic prediction models on the key heritable traits. That is to say, they're not highly responsive to the environment, or if they are, at least they're predictably responsive to the environment. Use those to parameterize crop growth models on a per genotype basis using those predictive parameters. So that would mean you'd be running potentially 1,000 different crop growth models because they'd all be parameterized slightly differently for each of the genotypes in your experiment. And you can also include predicted or simulated genotypes, which is fun because then you can think about, well, what would the optimal plant look like? What should I be targeting for this particular environment? And then using the crop growth model to integrate soil, climate, and management data with your component traits to predict these compound traits like yield. So the thing that I say is not probably as useful for a lot of plants, at least for a lot of species, is to try and use a genotype to predict yield. That can work a little bit sometimes, but you're gonna be a lot more accurate if you can predict the traits that are going to contribute to yield. And that will allow us to have much better transfer and higher predictive abilities to other locations, soils, stresses, and climates. And in fact, there are places that are doing this, industry is doing this, and one of the big applications that I've heard of is in, like, say at an international research center where a rural farmer comes in and says, I'm thinking about starting a breeding program in this new region of our country. What do you think would grow there? What material should I start with? What germplasm should we initiate this breeding program with? So you can look through current breeding populations or through current germplasm that's available through a germplasm bank, let's say, using what you know about the weather in this new environment, you can say, well, I think you should start with this set of 100 or 1,000 or whatever lines that might be most suited to your location. So that's another interesting application, I think, of that. For us, that means we can parameterize models in Michigan and test it by predicting out into all these other states that are growing some of the same material. So that's kind of exciting. Now I'm going to change courses completely and talk about something different. If there's any questions about crop growth modeling and whatnot before I move on, I'm happy to answer them now or later, doesn't matter to me. But if there aren't any pressing questions, I'm going to move on to tar spot. Okay, so When I came here to Michigan State a few years back, I met with the pathologist here who was telling me about this new disease that they had seen. And this would have been in 2018. And this disease, phylochromatis, is the pathogen that causes the disease called tar spot. It's an ascomycete fungi, and it grows specifically on maize, and it causes these black lesions. And if you like try and pick and scratch at them, they won't come off. They're like a 3D speck of tar is what it looks like. They're spread by wind and water, and they really like cool and humid conditions. So you're not going to be seeing this in Texas anytime soon. But it spreads quickly and can cause up to 40% yield loss. This disease has been in Mexico and Central America for the last 100 years or more, I think. But just recently, as of 3 years ago or so, it started in the Great Lakes region and has been spreading ever since. It's now into Iowa, Ohio, Illinois, Wisconsin, Michigan, basically the whole Great Lakes area. And it can spread very quickly, like I said, so it can go from just a couple of spots to having your leaf look like it's decimated, to having your whole canopy having problems. So this is within the range of just August 24th to September 7th. This is not a normal progression of dry down of maize. This is disease. And you can see here in this image, there's a spot that has pretty high disease level already. And what happens then, you have to kind of rotate the picture a little bit in your mind, but this is the region here that was here before. What happens then is it compromises stock quality significantly and it falls over. So this is all lodged here in this image. And so not only do you have poor quality for forages, but it can reduce the yield up to 40%, partly because of this lack of photosynthetic capacity, but also partly because it compromises the plant so much that it falls over. So now the thing is, we did not know anything about this disease in temperate germplasm. So it's been in Mexico and Central America. So there are some resistant lines there, but not much is known about resistance in general, but there's nothing known in temperate lines. And so that is where we stepped in and we said, okay, we're going to measure this and we're going to screen for resistance. And we started off with a couple of different populations. We started with this germplasm enhancement for maize, which is a fun private public partnership where they've taken industry elite inbred contributions, as well as some of the tropical material. Now, it has to be a little bit older tropical material because the more recent material has what we call an SMTA, Standard Material Transfer Agreement. I don't know how much you've learned in your plant breeding classes about the politics of breeding, but it is actually a significant area of thought and concern. So what has happened is that material coming out of some of the breeding programs now is not able to be used in any percentage in anyone else's breeding program. And so more modern material we can't use, but without in perpetuity having a tie back to the original creators of those lines. So this is a little bit older material for the tropical lines, but it's been integrated into the elite material that's temperate. So it's a mix of temperate and tropical, but it flowers here. And we've been testing that for resistance as well as a subset of the Wisconsin diversity panel lines in case there was anything there that looked promising. So we've been taking ratings weekly for the last couple of years and recording other phenotypes as well. This is just a picture of our rating scale to give you a sense that can range from very low percent infection. This is percent based on area of the leaf. It does go even higher than 50, but this is where I chose to stop this particular example. And we've got a bit of a team now working on this. Blake Trigestad is the master's student that is leading this project, but we have three undergrads currently working on it: Sydney Sitar, Sophia Holtz, and Emma Trudmansky. So it's a good team, I think. Based on last year's data, we noticed that traits like plant height and flowering time don't really associate with tar spot. And in some ways, this was good news for us because that means that the disease is spreading regardless of what else is going on with the plant. You know, the concern, if something is wind spread or, you know, we had no idea really of some of the pathology of the disease. And that's what Marty Chilvers, our pathologist here, is working on and his group. But you can imagine if a plant is tall or short, maybe it allows for extra air movement through the plot or something. But what we found was that there wasn't really an effect. And so things might flower earlier or later, but that's not going to affect how that particular plot was rated. All of our ratings, however, were pretty well correlated with each other. We also calculated an area of the under the disease progress curve to look at how disease develops over time. This year, we have this beautiful GIF that Blake created. So this is from this year's data up until about last Thursday, I think is week 6 that's included here. You can see our disease ratings vary from 0 all the way to 30%. So we've got really good disease pressure, and we're excited about using that data for mapping and creating resistant lines. You'll notice a little bit, he's working on right now adjusting the severity ratings for rater and for environment, because you'll see that as this disease progresses here, there's some places where it starts early on in the season, and those end up being some of the worst areas at the end of the season. So we don't necessarily want when disease started to strongly impact how much disease it had. We do have some, obviously this is replicated, so that helps a little bit. But we also had rater adjustments to make. The rating scale, I think we did a pretty good job of all being calibrated within a few percentage points. But it is a little tricky when you're out in the field to decide what is 15 versus 30% sometimes, or 1 versus 5%. And so what he had us do is we rated a couple of ranges all together. Well, we rated some all together, but then we also all rated them on our own. And he's using those as a way to statistically adjust for differences in rater scale. We have already started, as of last summer, back crossing our promising resistant lines into elite temperate, and this year into sweet corn lines. And we're developing new populations for further study, and also using these populations as a testbed for other technologies. Something I'll mention is that you'll notice that this front part is a little bit lower in disease, I think, toward the end. This is actually where some of the resistant populations are growing. So that's why we have kind of an effect there. So I have made progress, at least. They are more resistant. All right, so stay tuned. We will be having eventually drone-based, natural color, multispectral, and eventually hyperspectral and LiDAR data for these tar spot fields as well. This is actually an aerial of one of the tar spot trials. You can see it's under a center pivot irrigation. The reason for that is that tar spot really likes it when the leaves are wet. So in order to make sure that we get enough disease pressure, we apply frequent low doses of irrigation. When I say we, I actually mean the farmer. So these are all in collaboration with farmers on site on their farms, and they help take part in these trials. So technologies that are in development. One of the grad students in my group, Robert Schrott, is working on developing new algorithms for breeding population optimization and selection. So he's developing some genetic algorithms and machine learning approaches that can pull a subset of material from a larger breeding population in order to help inform what crosses you should make to achieve your goals in a quick fashion by looking forward throughout your program. I've got a rotation student and an undergrad working on some of our leaf spectral scans. So this is a really actually neat cutting edge device out of Jian Jin's lab at Purdue. He has a hyperspectral scanner that scans the whole leaf, and you get 100 or so wavelengths for each pixel. And so these two students are working on modeling of nutrient and water status, among other things. And then one thing that I was interested in doing that one of my master's students picked up on was the idea of doing a really cheap, fast genotyping test. So working with this undergrad who's now graduated, Fong, they've been working on a couple of different approaches to make basically kind of like a pregnancy test for presence, absence of genetic sequences. So if you were a breeder and you were out in the field and you wanted to, say, decide what, I'll give you a more tangible example. Let's say that you had created a a transgenic maize line and you had it in the high two background, which is not an inbred, but you want to be able to test the effect of that transgene in a uniform background. So you would want to cross your transgenic plants to an inbred, let's just say B73. Maybe it's an elite inbred instead of B73, but you're crossing it into something that is an inbred and useful. And in doing so, in doing all of those back crosses, you're going to want to do two things. You'll want to make sure that the transgene is there, but you'll also want to try to maximize the percentage of the recurrent parent, because you want to have as much of that elite parent or whatever inbred as possible. So this was the question I posed to these guys, and they're working on an approach to use, it's a couple different approaches. They're each taking a different approach, but basically it allows you to see whether a specific gene sequence is there, and they're working on seeing whether or not you can multiplex it to find a percentage of a background or not. That would be future work. And then also Eli and a rotation student, Elise, are working on image-based disease quantification. In Eli's case, this is in wheat. He's developed a really slick algorithm that quickly detects whether kernels are diseased or clean and what percentage of a sample is diseased. And so that would be, there are commercial platforms that do this, but this would be something that would be free and open source and very easy to do with just a flatbed scanner. So potentially applicable to like third world countries. And then Elisa is starting to work on a more quantitative approach to tar spot infection percentage. So in my time here at MSU, one of the things that I've done is develop a project partnership at the university. We call it Phenomics at MSU. When I got here, plant breeders and plant scientists didn't really have access to a lot of modern high throughput technologies. And we had a lot of really cutting edge computational modelers, but they didn't have access to the data sets they needed to develop and test algorithms, especially in the plant world. Those that were doing so by borrowing and collaborating with other institutions, other countries, other groups. And so we thought, wouldn't it be great if we can leverage both of those sets of expertise here? Because Michigan State has a lot of really unique agriculture. We have the second most diverse agriculture in the nation after California. We grow things like apples and cherries and berries and vegetables and all kinds of interesting things. So what we did was we got a strategic partnership grant through the university, which allowed us to purchase this giant drone unit that has co-aligned Veneer, Sphere, and LiDAR. And if you don't know what those things mean, you can ask me later, that's fine. As well as smaller sensor technologies for greenhouse and growth chamber assessments. And there's some really cool research going on here, but I will admit it is not my strength. I have another collaborator working on that part of the project, and he's got some cool stuff, again, I could talk about later and show you his website and that kind of thing. But this involves 23 different professors across 13 different departments at the university. So it's a nice big group of people with lots of different interests and expertise, all sort of coalescing around plant sciences, which I think is fantastic. We are just in the early to middle phase of this project, and we're working on a lot of data collection and pre-processing. We'll start doing analysis this fall and winter, which will be exciting. The other thing I wanted to highlight, there's a program here called IMPACTS, which is funded through the National Science Foundation as a research training grant that is an opportunity for graduate study where you can come in and have cross-training between computer and plant science. And there's some courses that are involved there as well as the training that's involved. And it's been pretty fantastic so far. We're in the second year of that now. So we're teaching the courses for the second time and everything. And I think one of the things that we're excited about coming out of this is improving communication between the plant and computer sciences. And an example I like to post of this, I apologize that the reference here has been stuck into the text somehow. But the example I'd like to give is this XKCD comic, where you've got a researcher that's in studying birds, maybe talking to a computer scientist. And they say, okay, when the user takes a photo, we want this app to check whether they're in a national park. The computer scientist says, okay, yeah, that's no problem. We can just look up what the location is and check whether it's a picture of a bird. And for this, she says, I'll need a research team in 5 years. So the caption here is that in computer science, it can be really hard to explain the difference between what is really easy and what is virtually impossible. And so for computer scientists, the challenge is understanding some of the plant science, but also understanding what the needs are and what is hard and what is easy. And in plant science, same thing. So there are a lot of things that plant scientists might be taking a lot of time and effort to do that could be really easily solved with some basic computational tools. But there could also be things that'll need a research team in 5 years. Both of those are worth pursuing and they're exciting. And what I like about this is that phenomics is starting to merge plant breeding and plant sciences. Those were previously two kind of disparate groups of people. You heard Ellen's lovely introduction of me. My undergraduate work was in genetics and my PhD was in like kind of developmental molecular genetics type stuff. And so my undergrad was actually not even in agriculture. It was humans, plants, flies, mice, bugs, plants, everything. I took some elective in some agricultural topics, but I come from a very mixed background. And then I got interested into the plant breeding and agricultural side of things. And I think it's really nice to have the diverse perspectives, especially now that we're incorporating computer scientists and engineers and everybody else. So more diverse perspectives, the better, I think. And just from the selfish perspective of the breeder, there's a lot of benefits to this. We're reducing error. We can account for or reduce or exploit our variability. We can maximize the heritability, which is the proportion of the phenotypic variation due to genetics. If we reduce all the error, we're maximizing what we can get for heritable variation. And that lets us make the best predictions using the best models. That lets us make the best crosses and then select the best progeny. So it's a more efficient progress. We make more efficient progress, saving time and money and generating applicable predictions. And we can also enable new scientific approaches. So for example, new phenotypes lets us measure things like chemical composition, nutrient content, water content, photochemicals. Something we're working on in collaboration with Eric Grotwald is looking at flavonoids and how that might interact with disease resistance, but also how we can predict that using spectral features. We can use temporal data to predict later season traits. So maybe you can even predict before you make a cross what that particular variety is going to do. We can collect, now we might be collecting many phenotypes, but it will enable us to collect just a few once we know which ones are important. And one of the applications I give to geneticists is that imagine you could screen tens of thousands of mutants for hundreds of traits all in a really short span of time. So even if you're not a breeder, there are applications for genetics. And we use mutants in breeding sometimes too. So I've been asked before to give kind of an overview slide of what it is that I do, and this is as close as I can get for the word version of it. Using crop growth modeling to move between environmental characteristics and biologically meaningful characteristics. Using phenotypic modeling to move between plant characteristics and these high throughput phenotypes. And using next-gen GWAS, VWAS, GPWAS approaches to inform high throughput phenotypes and genetic information here. So we've got GWAS and genomic prediction on this axis. And then if you're moving between environmental characteristics and high throughput phenotypes, we've got spatial variation, environmental characterization. And then kind of the interactions here, genotype specific crop growth modeling, GBite interactions to move between environment and genetics. So that's a really vague kind of overview. And if you don't to care for the words as much, the picture version of this is this slide, which is how I mentally characterize both what I do and the work of a lot of breeders. It's a mix these days of computers, quantitative genetics, phenotyping, field work, sometimes targeted work in growth chambers, lots of genetics, and sometimes lab work. So I made these pictures really small because I don't actually do much of this anymore. And long-term goals, as we all know, the bottom line is you really want to be able to inform future research and breeding efforts to optimize crop varieties and production systems. So any innovations that we make here, we want to be able to apply to places elsewhere. And this, in this case, is a nutritional deficiencies map, but if you have a heat map of calorie deficiency or of drought susceptibility, really the maps look about the same. So that is the end goal. And with that, I'm going to stop. I have a few minutes left for questions. but we can go over if you have extra questions. This is my team. Here we are socially distanced in some sweet corn, and then those who were not in the field that day. So thank you for listening. This was pretty fun. I'm gonna stop my screen share and we'll switch over. And I see that someone has put something in the chat. Okay, so this person is asking, why are we measuring anything other than yield as the response variable? That is a really great question. Let me finish reading it. Okay, so there's a number of questions here. And I might have one slide that I can pull up that would help with this. We'll see. Okay, so for the first part of your question, why measure things that aren't yield? Share screen, go to this slide. This is in a PDF format, but hopefully it gets the point across. Okay, so if we're looking at something like biomass or yield, as we both mentioned, there's a number of component traits that go into this. And you may be able, you are likely able to get a much higher trait in this category by optimizing what you're doing here. Because no single variety is going to have the best of all of these different component traits. You're going to have things that have higher yield, but probably those things are getting to that yield through different mechanisms. And so the argument I'd like to make is that by having these sensor technologies, we can measure and model some of these other traits that will get us to looking at these composite traits. I don't know if that is a helpful slide for you or not, or if it's just confusing. But I'm going to come back over here to your question so I can read the rest of it. So it is, the application is, I wouldn't say it's not mainly focused on moving into new environments. That's one exciting application of it. But keep in mind too that in thinking about new environments, that includes future climate change scenarios. So there might be times that you can't always measure something in the environment that you're trying to target. So it might be worth trying to optimize something without actually being able to measure it in that environment. Is there any part of this question that I have missed answering? Because you can type more or speak up on the mic.
Dr. Smith has his hand raised.
Oh, Dr. Smith.
Thank you. Great talk, really enjoyed it. I'll kind of put you on the spot. You talked about genomics, you talked about high throughput phenotyping, disease resistance. If you were a corn breeder making improved hybrids for Michigan, or you picked the spot, and you could choose one of those technologies plus just hardcore breeding, which one of those technologies would you add to your brute force breeding?
Okay, so I'm an old school breeder. I only use by hand phenotypic selection out in the field. I can add one technology. What would it be? That is tough. I would say it would depend a little bit on what my problems were in the area that I was in. If my main problem was that I wanted to change the structure of the plant or something physical about the plant, something that was an obvious difference visually. It depends on the heritability of the trait too. But let's say I was a dry bean breeder and I was looking to breed beans that grew short stature and didn't climb a bunch, right? In that case, I would want to add some drones. and be able to just phenotype giant areas of land without having to send people out in the field. Also, the question is the pandemic still on? Because that has limited who we can send where. So that field indicator that we went to every week, it's 2 hours away and we have to ride one student per vehicle. So we had a fleet of cars going out and coming back. But if I was working in a region where the main problem was a disease, then I would definitely want to take genotyping as my one added approach. Because you cannot guarantee that you're going to get even distribution of that disease every year. And if you want to make any sort of progress in your breeding program, you need to have a way to choose what to cross without being able to necessarily phenotype it accurately. So if you can use genetics to make improvement, that's fantastic. And that would be a big help. So I guess it's kind of a cheating answer because I said it depends, but that's the real answer. It depends.
It's okay. Thank you.
So a lot of what you've talked about is leaf and leaf area. Have you done any phenotyping about roots?
Now, this is the one area where I start to agree with the person who asked the question in the group chat. In my mind, if the roots do not have a major impact on any of the other traits above ground that you're looking at, then why are you looking at them? Again, I don't want to say that as just a blanket statement, but if I had to make one blanket statement, that would be it. But if you had a scenario where the roots were playing a major role, you'd probably see it above ground. Now there could be a situation where maybe you have soil that's really deplete of phosphorus. And so you want a particular root structure that scavenges for phosphorus. The other thing that I have learned just this year in working on a project with a company that's doing like added bioapplications and sort of things is that you can learn quite a bit from the roots about what the plant has been through. So it's not necessarily about learning what it's capable of, but you can see some of its history by looking at the roots. So actually, you know what? The advantage of having this remote lecture is I can actually pull up some examples. We might as well take advantage of that because this is kind of fun. So by looking at the roots and looking at when the various structures of that root have formed, we can learn a little bit about particular stresses that have gone on for that plant. So share screen, bear with me for just another 2 seconds. Okay, so this is a picture of some plant that was pulled out of our field. It's a hybrid, and this field had a pretty warm and very dry summer. It was not irrigated, we didn't have a lot of rain. And so part of what this guy that had split this for me is looking at, he's looking at how many nodes have formed, how much of this has died off as a result of these things being shut down after they weren't very effective. All of these things can happen because of certain conditions in your soil or in your environment for that year. So I think that roots are very important for telling a story, especially when it comes to management or consulting in a crop. I don't know if that's important for telling me what to select in the future, because to me it's a response. And this is very informative of what that material has been through rather than going forward. But I would be excited and happy to be convinced otherwise. In the meantime though, I think that's actually kind of a cool way to look at it. Okay, I think I saw another question in the chat. Ah, so I put this is a picture of my border of my sorghum population. I put this up because I teach the intro advanced plant breeding course at the graduate level. And what we will get into later in the semester is cytoplasmic male sterility. So this is it would be hybrid seed that was selfed. So this is basically the progeny of, this is like an F2 population. So it's segregating for sterility. So it looks weird because you've got some that don't have any seed on it and then some that have seed. So don't give away the secret to my students, but that's what that is.
Dr. Thomson, I'm going to have to go. So I'm going to stop the recording and turn over hosting to you. So you can continue your sessions, but I really appreciate you coming and speaking. Thank you.
Yeah, great. Thanks, and thanks for hosting.
Let me interrupt. Seth has his hand up.
But I think Seth, he's clapping, maybe.
Bear with me for a moment.